with worse first with
Sorry. I'm fine. I'm not nervous.
With Mickey Avalon, who I'm sure you've heard of. He's a freaking amazing musical artist. He is actually on my husband's new album coming out. Andrew, you have an amazing song on there, which I'm so excited about. I can't wait to share that. And yeah, like I've known you for a while and I've known you through Simon too.
Yep.
Simon Rex, who was also on the podcast, who we love, the Dirt Nasty. He's amazing. You guys tour together a lot.
Yep. He's my best friend, I think. Yeah. I don't know if I'm his best friend. But he's my best.
Can you imagine, like, you're like, he's my best friend, and then he comes on the pod, he's like, I kind of know him.
Yeah, yeah.
a little bit. So I'm so glad you came all the way out to hot ass Calabasas.
Yeah, thank you.
It's only 109 degrees outside. I don't even know why I put makeup on.
It's nice in here, though. You got good AC.
I got it cooled down for you. And I'm just so happy to have you here. I know a lot of people don't like to make the drive, so I'm really grateful.
That's all right.
And, you know, I talked to you before you came and told you a little bit about kind of what we do here on Worst First is we make people feel better about their own lives by talking about some of the worst shit that's happened to us. And it can be, like, funny or it can be...
I think most of the stuff I would talk about, I would hope would be funny because... Real worst stuff, I'd rather not.
Yeah, nobody wants to talk about the real worst stuff. That's like a dark, that's for the dark podcast.
I mean, sometimes it's funny after, like, you laugh about it. Like, I went to some AA meetings in my life before, and what was cool about it was everyone would tell the worst stories, but then they would all laugh, like, on unison, and it was because, and no one else would have laughed at that stuff, but it's because you live through it, so it's funny, you know?
Yeah, that's, well, it's kind of helps, I think, with trauma. I like laugh about a lot of my trauma. That's like how I got into comedy was all the trauma just builds up and then you can't do anything but laugh.
And I think all funny comedians have to have a traumatic life.
Seriously. I don't think I've met one comedian who hasn't had a traumatic life. Like they've been through some crazy shit.
And I mean, that's what makes you interesting, I think.
Yeah. And where did you grow up?
I grew up in Los Angeles.
You do grow up in LA.
Yep.
So you're an LA kid.
Yep. I was born at County General Hospital. In East Los Angeles, and then I grew up in Hollywood and near West Hollywood.
Whoa.
You say West Hollywood, everyone thinks you like grew up like...
Rich.
No, in Boys Town. Like,
oh, Boys Town.
On Santa Monica Boulevard.
Yeah.
Like getting your dicks up for money, but that never happened. Well, not in Boys Town.
Grew up in West Hollywood, like as a
like
kid?
Like I watched the Beverly Center get built. I'm probably aging myself now. I used to ride pony, like where the... Rexall is. I don't even know if it's Rexall anymore. It's probably Rite Aid or something. Where that was, there was like pony rides in the circuit.
Oh my God. So what high school did you go to?
I went to Beverly Hills High for 1 year because my grandma lived there. So I used her address.
Uh-huh.
My mom had already moved to Burbank at that time. And then I just went there for a year and because it just wasn't my scene. And then I went to a school called Excelsior, which isn't there anymore. It's right on Franklin and Highland.
Uh-huh.
There's like a big homeless tent right there now.
Wow.
It was just a little school. I just went to schools basically that I could get out at noon. They weren't like continuations for smarter kids, I guess.
Wow.
Or not for smarter kids. I just wasn't retarded. But but it was like a continuation.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So by then I was already selling weed and I just wanted to be out of school.
How old were you selling weed?
So like 13.
13?
Yeah.
Who did you get the weed from?
My mom.
Stop. Your mom was like, go sell this?
Well, no. That sounds worse than it really is, actually. No, my mom was a weed dealer because that's how she supported us. And then I knew as much as a kid could know, you know? Uh-huh. Like I knew my mom, I knew they like always smelled like weed and stuff, but I didn't like, no.
Did they grow it?
No, just they smoke weed too. I think the smell was more from the smoking up. And my mom doesn't care if I talk about any of this stuff because she doesn't sell weed anymore.
Weed, who cares?
And it's legal. Weed. And then they don't even do it. She doesn't even do it anymore. But
right.
But that sounds terrible. Yeah, go sell this. It wasn't like that. So I started buying, and she had really good weed.
Wow.
So I started selling dirt weed. I buy a 20 bag. And make 5 nickel bags. So I made $5 for each one. And then my mom knew I was doing that. And she didn't want me to get in trouble. And she didn't want herself to get in trouble. So then she called me in the room one day. And then she showed me like this really good weed. And she's like, how much do you need to sell? This was at the very beginning. Because then I got better at it and made good money. But she's like, how much do you need? Oh, and also she said she was when I started smoking weed, she was bummed because I was real nice to my sister once I started smoking weed.
Because you just got so mellow.
Yeah, and I wasn't before, so she was like torn.
What happened? Yeah.
She didn't, like, she should have wanted me not to do that because it's not good for teenagers because it could take away their motivation and stuff. But since I was nice to my sister for the first time in my life, she didn't nix it. So then she's like, okay, how much you need? I was like, well, I just need to make like an eighth for myself and a little pocket money. So, and they call this weed the Fruity Pebbles because it smelled like Fruity Pebbles.
Yum.
They didn't call, my friends call it that. Yeah. So basically I got a half ounce a week and three. So there was, that's 4/8 in case people don't know.
I'm so bad at math. You don't even have to explain that part.
So
why did you need money for it? 13 though.
I didn't need like money. It was just more for like.
You're like, man, I got a lifestyle. I got to pay for my bike and
It was my bag. So, okay. So three guys got each an eighth and then I got the fourth one.
Wow.
So then that was the beginning. And then I just got better at it.
But, was weed your first drug?
Yep. Probably alcohol, but weed. I mean, also now when I, 13 sounds so young, you know, but I think we just were in a rush to grow up a lot quicker back then.
Yeah.
Now the kids don't drive anymore. They don't know how to tie their shoes. They don't know handwriting.
They just know iPad.
They know
They're
iPad.
They're like iPad, TikTok.
Yeah, like from the gate. And you can't get mad. I get it. The parents are fucking exhausted. They probably were like, I'm not going to be the parent that gives my kid the iPad. And then they haven't slept for 3 days. And they're like,
watch the iPad, watch TV.
And then
TV,
the kid writes Pokemon, and then Poke a Man comes up, and then he sees his first gay porn at like 4, and it's like, and it's off to the races. You know?
I just heard about that. Kids were looking up Pokemon, and they found Poke a Man, and they were watching gay porn.
Yeah. And like,
that's a lot when you're little.
Yeah. Yeah. Like the porn now, I couldn't even watch. It would
devastating.
Be like a horror movie. It'd be like watching Saw or one of those movies, you know? Like we used to have to like go find a magazine like under a rock.
I know. I remember I found my first porno magazine in my dad's closet on the top shelf, and he only had one, and he bought it because it was a collector's item. It was the first issue of Playboy without the staple.
Oh, wow.
And it was Madonna.
Okay. And not the first issue of Playboy.
Without the staple.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah, because they were stapled before
first
one with glue,
sense.
Right?
Okay.
So it was Madonna, and she had huge armpit hair.
Yeah, I remember that.
And a bush almost up to her fucking belly button. And I was like, oh my God.
Yeah.
Oh, dear Lord. Like, I was so traumatized by that. I was like, what is going on down there? You know, because I was like 6.
Yeah.
You know, but I remember keep looking at it because I was so interested.
I grew up on Bush.
Yeah,
but I remember the armpits would freak me out, and it was more than an.
It was a lot.
It was
of bush.
A lot of bush. Like
she's Italian.
Yeah, like it could have been like a little.
Yeah,
and that was before like girls in
were
shape.
Doing that.
Yeah.
She was ahead of her time.
She was totally ahead of
for
her
everything.
Time.
But I remember looking at it and being like, Jesus Christ! Yeah. Let me see that again.
No, it's that's it. That's it.
So that's crazy. So you're an LA kid. So like, did you grow up with like a lot of people that ended up becoming famous? Because I feel like everybody does. Like that you grew up in LA, you know automatically just because so many people out here.
Yep. I mean, a few people. The first porno movie I ever got was from The Alchemist. That producer, you know, so we were friends, and he was just Al then, and then there was this porno called Taboo, and it was about a guy fucking his mom, but it wasn't really his mom, obviously, and it was just, that's when porn was just people having sex, you know.
Oh my God.
And then that just got passed around and everything. I mean, I'm sure nice and plenty of people. I mean, I met a lot of people, famous people through Simon, probably. Never, maybe because I grew up out here, it's not.
And
I never wanted to be famous. Like, that's not something I ever wanted to do. And then probably selling drugs. I mean, not that I thought weed was a drug, but I kind of wanted to be invisible. You know?
Yeah.
Like, my mom taught me how to
fly under the radar.
Yeah. She's just like said, Bob Dylan said, if you live outside the law, you just got to be honest. So that was like, and then keep your car, like don't have a broken, tail.
Yeah.
Keep
all your plates updated, that stuff.
Yeah.
So did you ever get caught?
Nope. I never got caught.
Good.
It would be I mean, I did, I've gotten arrested for other stuff. I never got caught for that, but it was stressful because it was nowhere near being legal.
Right.
So
at that time, it was
at that time. Yeah. So then driving around, you have like stomach problems, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, I never had IBS or anything like
but
that.
Anxiety.
Yeah. And I never really had anxiety for other stuff, just that.
Uh-huh.
And then when I got strung out on real drugs, is when my mom.
So how did you go from, if you're comfortable talking about it, how did you go from like weed to the other shit? Is it just like a progression? You're just like, oh, I want to try this next?
No, I mean, that's probably how it is for a lot of people. Okay, like I drank when I was, I drank probably since a little kid, but didn't realize it because it was just like my mom's boyfriend's beer. Just like, I always want to be grown up.
Yeah, he would leave him around. You'd be like, I'll finish this.
Yeah, they wouldn't even care. Like, just laughing, you know, like at barbecues. Like, I'd just be the fucking funny kid doing stupid shit. And you didn't realize like someone was an alcoholic. Like, he would always have like a six pack in the car and like, but it was beer. So it wasn't like,
right.
You wouldn't think that that was alcoholism, you know?
Yeah.
And then I did weed, and then I did like psychedelics, and I liked that. And then I never thought I would do the hard stuff because my dad was a junkie. And then, so it was like something I would not, I knew that that would probably be like, I could be that, you know? So then I moved out of the house when I was in senior in high school, got an apartment in the same building as my dad, and I was trying to get him sober, which I did. Well, he got himself. I didn't get him sober. But I was trying to help get him into a spot, and then I got him into the spot. But then while that was happening, I was like a lot. Like, so then I started drinking. Like, I never drank, like, get a thing
every
of whiskey
day, yeah.
And drank to get, like, numb, you know? So then I did that, and then I met some new friends, and then so then I was like, as I'm getting him in, it's pretty ironic, you know, as I'm getting him into the place, and then he got into the place, and then he was sober for the rest of his life.
Wow.
It was only a few years, but awesome. Yeah. And then I just got, that's a worse first. I just put my arm out, and my buddy did it, and then my eyes were like a
roll back in your head.
Yeah, like a.
Cha-ching.
Yeah,
like a little cartoon,
like a cartoon, yeah. Like a slot machine, yeah. Where like you see that, but it's like and then it definitely.
You weren't scared to do heroin.
I mean, I was scared for that reason that like up until at the time I wasn't, but I was scared like, oh, I shouldn't do that, and like my whole life I thought I'll never do that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I was scared to do it myself because I wouldn't know how to do it.
Yeah,
you know what I mean,
you learn
pretty quick. But and then it just rang that bell, and then
what does it feel like for people that have never done it?
People say it's like it's nothing like sex. Sex is a totally different thing. Maybe it's like doing some of those chemicals,
that endorphin release when you have an orgasm or whatever.
Maybe that's what they're talking about. Yeah. But like I got nauseous, but I mean I threw up, but. It was like a good throw up.
How is that fun? I fucking hate throwing up.
I don't like throwing up either, but there's like the throw up where it's like not coming out and you're like, ugh, and it's like won't stop. And then there's just like, it comes out and then you're back to the next, you know, like you smoke a cigarette and you're like, it just feels, you're just like peaceful, I guess. I've heard like anyone who has addiction or alcoholism, and I consider it pretty much the same, that like you'd hear about that like that bell kind of ringing. You're like, oh, this is it.
You loved it.
Yeah. And then
even though you threw up, you loved it.
Yeah, because I just go throw up, come back. We were at Mel's Diner on Sunset.
Classic Mel's, yeah.
And just go to the bathroom, come back. I remember I was eating the salad, had like honey mustard
you
dressing.
You were eating on heroin?
Yeah, I was eating before, and then I was like, it was good. And I like never had any money or food, so I was like, and my friend the drug dude was kind of rich, and then that dude actually was hanging out with my dad as I was getting him into the place.
Wow.
And then like fucked up my shit.
He was like, try heroin? He like suggested you try it?
No, I like, by that point I was not trying to think, oh, this is not what I need to be doing. At that point I was like, oh, I want to fucking be like Lenny Bruce or some shit, you know what I mean? And I wanted to be a painter, and that guy painted, and it was like I kind of just manifested that in my life. But then he was hanging out with my dad and giving my dad drugs, so then I had to kick his ass and had to switch the locks on the door, had to put it on backwards because I finally got my dad to the spot. And then they're like, you have to detox before you come in here. And I'm like, well, how the fuck? That's the whole fucking point.
They don't detox you in this place?
This place wasn't a detox. Oh. So I'm like, well, if we could pull that off, then we wouldn't be here to begin with.
Yeah.
So I had to lock the door from the backside so he couldn't get out. And then he got in, and then he was there for a year, and it worked. But then he came to visit me with this. They got to come with the chaperone, and the fucking dude found a roach in my ashtray and smoked it, and then he ratted on himself, and then my dad couldn't visit me for the rest of the year. So it was pretty shitty. But
what a piece of shit.
He was a piece of shit. Well, that's what they fucking tell him. Like, it's like, dude, they say, like, tell, you know, do what you got, but don't do it if it's going to hurt somebody else.
Right.
Like, you don't go tell someone I fucked your wife if just so you could feel better.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So
how long did you do heroin for?
So that was 17. And then, so that's when my mom cut me off. So then I didn't have, and then I got married and moved away to Oregon. And
Portland.
To Portland. And then I just had a shoebox with 10 grand in it, which I thought was like $1 million. But, and rent was way cheaper back then. Like, we got a big house for $900 a month. But when you're not making money, 10 grand goes
really quick.
Fast.
Yeah.
So then my mom said, she let me do like one more deal. Like, I flew home, and then I just got a job at Noah's Bagels, and then that was how I supported it.
Were you doing heroin at Noah's?
I would get clean for little bits of time, but for the most part, okay, so yeah, so that was the question, how long? Probably like maybe 20 years or something.
You did heroin for 20 years?
Yeah, probably.
How did you not die?
I don't know. I tried once.
You tried to overdose?
Yeah, I tried to overdose once.
And you couldn't?
You know,
your body's like, no, we throw up now.
Well, kind of funny. No, I only threw up the first time.
Oh, okay.
I'm laughing about you doing heroin.
No, it's like, funny. I'm such a piece of shit. I'm like,
No, it's funny because it could have even been more than 20 years. I don't know.
Jesus Christ. I take like a strong Advil and I'm like, that's it. I'm dying. I'm ODing.
Well, that's my mom, who's not an addict.
Yeah.
She's like, she gets a Vicodin from the hospital or something.
Yeah.
Not that she goes to the hospital a lot, but.
Right.
She's like, this is the worst. It sucks. I'm constipated. So there's definitely.
And then there's people
that get addicted like to drugs that also aren't addicts. Like if you get a back surgery and the doctor gives you addictive drugs and you take them for
pain
a long time, you're going to get addicted to it.
I hate that shit.
But then if you could get off of it, it's not going to come creeping up anymore because you're not an addict.
It's so interesting, isn't it? Because there are some people that it's just.
Yeah.
Immediate.
Yeah, yeah.
They love it. Like I have friends, you know?
I loved it.
They love it. And I can't even drink alcohol without getting sick. My body rejects almost everything.
That's good.
Some vitamins, like if I take zinc,
I
throw up. Like my body's just like, nope, nope, like to everything.
I mean, I think I just built up a good tolerance. But when I tried to, broke up with my wife. And I was super bummed. And by this point, we weren't in Portland anymore. We were in Eugene because she went to U of O.
Eugene.
Oregon. So still in Oregon.
Okay.
Left, you know, all my friends and family and lived out there. And then she went to U of O. So then I didn't live with her, but I lived down the street.
Yeah.
And then I'm like, okay, dude. You know, I'm young, fucking hopeless romantic. So then I'm like, okay, fucking it. So like, I didn't write a note or anything like that. I knew like, this is more than I could do, you know? So then I also had a job interview the next day for like,
telemarketing or
kind
some
of
shit,
like those like, surveys.
Right.
So then I did the whole thing and then I woke up in the morning.
And like, you're like, why am
record,
I still here?
I was still, well, I'm like, I'm here and I don't have any drugs anymore. And I have this job interview. I got the job and then I tried to do it one more time, but then I left some for in case I woke up again and I did. And then I'm like, okay, this isn't the way. And I never really wanted to.
You gave yourself more than you could take twice.
Yeah, but
and
it
you
wasn't,
woke up both times.
Yeah, it wasn't more than I could take. I think I would have to take a lot more, but it was still a lot. It was like a gram, and I probably did like a fifth of that in a shot normally, you know. So,
and how did it make you feel when you did that much? Was it crazy?
I just passed out.
You just passed out.
Well, I woke up like I was on my records, like flipping through my, like, I was like that on the, so it was probably not a good record.
You weren't scared or anything?
I was scared when I was doing, because I never was like a suicidal kid like that. Like, I never had a, like, real depression or anything like that. Like,
I'm
I got
so scared of dying, my biggest fear.
I'm not scared of dying. I mean, I've also done, I mean, everyone I know is dead, so.
Well, except for me. You're just talking to my ghost right now. Yeah. You're not even at my podcast.
It's like an apparition. Yeah. But
everyone I know.
But I probably was scared because just human. I mean, then I was scared.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, you know, and I love my mom and stuff, you know,
yeah.
Like at the time. So then.
Is your mom not out here anymore?
Oh, no, my mom's here.
Okay, so she's not dead.
She's the only one that's alive.
Oh,
and my girl.
And Tommy and Minnie.
And you guys,
Sierra.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's crazy. And you're so young, too, still.
Yeah, I'm not as young as I used to be. But that time I was really sad, like, when I got into this. But I didn't have, like I was always a happy-go-lucky kid. Like, I had the worst situation of anyone, like, in my school. But it never hit me like that because I didn't have I had them as a frame of reference, but I didn't have another frame of reference. Like, I remember in class once, like, ninth grade or something, and they're like, has any of you ever thought about killing yourself? And the whole class raised their hand.
What?
And these are, like, rich kids with, like,
good little brats.
I know, and I was like, what the fuck?
My dad didn't get me a Maserati, yeah, so I want to kill myself.
Totally. So
I know, but it is true. Money has nothing to do with depression. Like, fuck.
Totally.
I've learned that.
No, I get it. No.
Yeah.
I just, I don't remember what we were talking about, but.
But, yeah.
I got the job. I lost the job because you had to get the survey till the end. And a lot of times they would, like, stop, like, and hang up, like, two questions out.
Yeah.
And they could listen to you at any time.
Yeah.
So I would just pretend like they're still on the phone and keep talking.
Stop. It's hilarious. Then, they were like, you're fired.
Yeah. So.
Wow.
So, yeah, that was a long stretch. I got clean a few times back and forth. It was way before I got into music. That wasn't anything I ever thought about doing. Like, I did a few songs with my friend. Like, I liked rap music and I like doing it, but I want to be a painter.
Yeah. Your art is great, by the way.
Thank you.
I love your art.
I was I'm gonna bring you guys a painting of your dog.
Wiener,
I
just the wiener.
So that was that. Worked in Noah's Bagels for a while and then I came home at some point. But you told me to think of a worst first before.
That's
I came
all worst.
So, that's all bad.
First
I wasn't
time
planning
doing
on
heroin, first time.
But I thought
fucking
I got a first arrest, actually, my second arrest was out there. My first arrest was home. I was a teenager, 1992, during the riots. So I didn't go out during the... I mean, all my friends were out looting. There was great parties at the time. Everyone had alcohol and meat and sound systems. And so it was like the second or third days kind of cooled down a bit. And we went to go eat at Zanku Chicken. Me and my friend Matt and Billy, he had a Dodge Demon. I was old enough to drive yet, and I had a car, but he was just the one driving that day. Mm-hmm. So we're eating a Zanku Chicken on Sunset in Normandy, and then there's a 7-Eleven across the street. Excuse me. Mm-hmm. And it looks burnt. It's burnt down.
Oh, shit.
But people are running in and out of it with shit. So we're like, I wonder what they're getting in there because it's burnt down.
Mm-hmm.
So we finish our meal. We walk over there and everything burnt except the ice cream section, which was obviously melted by this point, and the beer section.
Mm-hmm.
So then he brings his car around. We fucking filling the trunk up with beer, drinking while we're doing it. We're like stoked.
And then
so I'm just like 17 or 18. Well, we got away. Me and Billy got away.
Oh, dope.
Cops come. And this is when, like, there were so many people getting arrested. They didn't even have handcuffs. They did
zip ties.
Yeah. So we got away. We should have just went on the bus and went home.
But you drove.
But, well, no, we can't. Part of it was, like, we wanted to see if our buddy was okay.
Yeah.
And then the other part was, like, well, he's the one, you know. So we came back and we were, like, seeing what was up. Matt's getting arrested. And then someone pointed us out to him. And then we got arrested. We're in the we're in the paddy wagon, and this girl, and all our hands are behind our back, and then she's like, I got two 20 bags in my pocket. On the back had like a little screen, like not a window.
Okay, you know what I mean? like a screen, like an outdoor screen?
No, like a screen with holes in it.
Okay.
So then my buddy, like went behind, like got it out of her pocket and like pushed it through, out through the window.
So she wouldn't get her.
And I don't know how this happened because it doesn't make any sense, but they landed perfectly on the bumper and stayed there the whole time. Like all the way till we got to Wilcox Station.
Stop.
And then we were kind of buzzed from the booze. I mean, it's just beer, but we're young. So then we get there and they're like, whose is this? If you don't tell, everyone's getting in trouble. And everyone knew better. Like you learn that like in kindergarten. Like
you don't say anything.
Yeah. Cause they're like, so and so already said that. And then you're like, they did? Okay. And then you learn that like no one told, like they didn't know.
Yeah. Yeah.
So then instead of calling my mom, because I knew she'd be not happy. So then I called my dad and he just picked me up, was laughing. And then like 6 months later, I had to go to, you know, court. But I was under 18, so.
Get in trouble? Like was it a big deal? Did you have to do
No, they
service?
Dropped. I didn't even have to do community service. It was like one of those things, like so many people
got arrested.
Like if you weren't like on film, on TV, like smashing a brick on someone's face, like you're fine.
Probably just like the last Black Lives Matters movement, like when a bunch of people got arrested.
Now it was way different than that. Like that shit, it was ready to pop. Like, yeah, this was crazy. The George Floyd thing, like we were finally, and they're like, we're not going to let people get away with this. But most of the looters, like the protesters and the looters, were two totally different things. Like the looters wanted new sneakers, and they were, and then it just really exploded.
So you think it was bigger this last time than it was before?
No, I think the 92 was, I think now they can do more.
Yeah.
Because like there's social media and there's this, and then like whether or not the guy ends up getting, second degree murder or not, he'll probably have some great lawyer, but like no one thought that Rodney King, like no one thought those cops were going to get it. So then when it happened, it just was like crazy. Yeah, you know what I mean? Like the whole, like shit, the whole city was on fire. Like here, they're like, okay, go fucking fuck up Melrose. Go do it. Like
Melrose got fucked up.
But like, that's it. Like,
yeah.
It wasn't like all of South Central got, you know.
That was how it was in 92.
Yeah.
It was just destroyed.
Yeah, just destroyed. And then when the National Guard came in, there were literally like tanks in the street. But like the whole, everything was like, there's just, it's like how the fires are.
Yeah.
Like when you guys had to leave. Yeah. Cause like, it was like that.
Yeah.
But in inner city, you
know?
Dude,
that's so intense that you lived through that.
I mean, it was crazy. My mom lived through the Watts riots, the, you know, 30 years before that. So,
dude, that's so gnarly.
Yeah.
So that was your first time getting arrested.
That was my first time.
And you were 17?
Yep, I was 17. And then I was like thinking about their story. It's like nowadays, you know, you don't know, like.
Wait, so I have so many questions for you.
Because
you've had this crazy life. You grew up in LA. Your dad was a heroin addict. Your mom was a weed dealer. You're like,
but she's like a nice little Jewish lady.
Of course, So it's not like I'm imagining her to be some vicious person. I'm mostly a hippie more than anything.
Yeah,
right?
They were both pretty hippie-ish.
Yeah,
or at least in the 60s and 70s.
Yeah, it's not like, you know, everyone's, you know, it's not just because you yield weed.
Weed is
to me so innocent. Whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's crazy because like you had this insane life and then. Now you're known as Mickey Avalon, like the rapper. And like, you know, how did you even go from that to starting music?
And it's funny because people are like, are these stories true? And I'm like, these are the watered down versions of my real life.
Don't water it down.
I'm saying like, and it's not like, oh, is Mickey Avalon, is that like an act or whatever? It's like, if anything, it's less.
And that's not your real name.
No, okay, so.
Do you tell your real name or no?
Yeah, no, my real name is Yeshi Pearl. Yeshi's Tibetan. My folks were hippies. They traveled to Tibet and Nepal and all those places. And then the Dalai Lama's right-hand man was named Lama Yeshi. And then he would name people. So, like, before I was born, like, he goes into a trance and then he gives you a name. But he never gave anyone his name. But then he gave me his name.
He gave it to your mom when you were
pregnant? Yeah, like before I was born. My dad didn't want me to be named that because he just said it was goofy. But I look at it as like a boy named Sue. Like, you know that Johnny Cash song?
Yeah. Like, I like the name Yeshi.
I mean, I like it now, but I'm saying as a kid, you walk in and then like your first day at school and everyone laughs, but I think it just makes you tougher. But I wasn't, and it's funny because like when I was a kid, I wanted a name like John or Chris or something. And then when I started music and then we wanted to make up porn names because all the rap names were kind of goofy.
Yeah.
So we're like, let's just do like porn names instead of. But by that time, I like my name. I wasn't looking for like a new identity or anything. We just wanted funny porn names because we weren't trying to get famous or do it. We were just messing around.
So how'd you land on Mickey Avalon?
So the porn name is supposed to be the last name is the street you grew up on, and then the first name is your pet. So my mom lived on Avon Street, which didn't sound cool.
Right.
And my friend Armin, he changed his was Andre Legacy. That was his rap name.
Oh, yeah.
And I didn't realize that he's the best with the nicknames. So he gives everyone nicknames. And then Andre Legacy was supposed to be Andre Agassi, like the tennis player. And I'm like, why do you want to name yourself after Andre? He's like, because he serves fools. That's the dumbest shit. Oh, but he's hilarious and does the best nicknames. So Avon became Avalon because there's nothing cool about Avon.
Yeah.
And then I never really had any pets. So
you never had
any
pets?
I had like a goldfish that I went at the, at the carnival. Aww. And then, we had a little dog named Tiger for like 2 weeks and he bit everyone and then he had to get taken away. So he just came up with it just had a good ring. He's like,
Mickey.
We're like, Avalon. He's like, Mickey Avalon. And then, I didn't think anything was going to become of it. Then met Simon and, there's a lot of stories about how it happened. And then, my friends don't call me that. It's just more, I guess less confusing if, I just go by that in the public eye.
So when you introduce yourself to someone in real life, what do you introduce yourself as?
To a friend.
Okay.
It's kind of the difference between, people are funny, you know what I mean? Like, and I get the psychology of it. Like if someone isn't a friend, not that they're an enemy, they're just not a friend. And then like I'm at a show like backstage and if they know my name, they'll like it's like puts them in a different, like they'll call my name and so then I turn thinking it's like someone I know and it's not someone I know.
Yeah, it's just someone trying to fucking.
Like I know
you, bro. Yeah. I know you. Yeah but they just Wikipedia'd you.
Yeah. And then the weirdest thing, like Wikipedia, you could write anything.
Right.
You know what I mean? So for a while, I had this crazy long Jewish name on Wikipedia.
Which wasn't your name.
Which wasn't my name. And it just was weird. And so, yeah.
That's crazy. Oh my God. I'm loving this. Okay. Guys, we are going to take a quick break and then we are going to be back on Worst First with Mickey Avalon, AKA Yeshi Pearl. Right back. Hang on. Okay, everybody, we are back on Worst First with Mickey Avalon. We got Nina the Wiener Dog. She's getting closer.
Yeah, she
she's
is.
Moving in.
And it's so crazy. She's so loud
when you come in.
And you would never think that, like, she's a professional.
She knows when mom's podcasting. I'm like, bitch, this is how I pay for your dog treats, you know?
The good
like,
ones, I bet.
I am not a made woman. I have to pay my own bills,
and
you know?
She probably gets that good Calabasas food.
She does. You know? I cook their dog food. She's spoiled.
They used to call it Cala Blacklist because no black people lived here.
Oh my God.
The Kardashians came, and now it's
then
not.
Then came all the black people.
Yeah, it's not. They don't call
crazy.
It that anymore. Yeah.
Actually, that's a really good point. I've seen, like, three black people, and I think it was like Will Smith and like his kids.
Yeah.
There should be more black people in Calabasas.
There should be more black people everywhere.
I know. I actually, you know what? You just brought up a really good point. I can't believe they used to call it Cala Blacklist. That's hilarious.
Yeah.
Because I was just thinking that. I'm like, fuck, I don't see like any black people ever.
Yeah.
I just see a bunch of old heads and like, yeah, like the one black person I saw, I think was Jaden Smith. Yeah.
And that was it, like Sugarfish.
Wow. Living in a bubble, need to evolve. Yeah, that's crazy. So we're back with you, and you said you have a worst story about the first time you had
first
sex.
Well, just first.
And yeah,
it
worst
was,
first.
It
yeah.
was worst at the time because it was awkward as fuck. So my dad told me he lost his virginity when he was 14 years old.
Uh-huh.
So then I'm like, I have to beat that.
Yeah.
But I never really thought about it again. until like a week before I was about to turn 14.
Uh-huh.
So then I'm like, I'm on a mission.
Yeah.
Like, I have to make this happen. So then I had a friend that was a girl, and my grandma, that was my first year in high school. I said I went to Beverly High.
Right.
And my grandma lived like 3 blocks from the school.
Mm-hmm.
So then we're like, I basically talked to her, and like I told her the whole story, and she's like, she was down. And
you're like, I gotta beat my dad's record.
Pretty much.
You're hot.
Yeah,
I'm hot.
That's how it was.
Let's well,
I didn't
do this.
Hot, but right, she's right. Hot. She was French.
Ooh.
She had a French name.
She's like, what do you want to do?
Yeah, they like they're giving blowjobs at that age already.
Right.
You know, like they smoke.
She's all
like
smoking.
Six.
Yeah, she's like one of those cigarettes that has like an extension on it. She's like, what do you want? She's sitting in a robe with like a tit out.
Yeah. So we go. So we walk from the school at lunch break, and I'm like thinking, you know, I'm thinking about it all day. So then we walk through the alley to my grand, sneak around my grandma's pool, and then a pool room, and then in the pool room, like a little bathroom, like half the size of your bathroom.
Yeah.
Like the smallest bathroom, like you're basically like
an airplane bathroom?
Kind of like an airplane bathroom with maybe a little bigger. Like there's mirror. Toilet.
Yeah.
So then, and she's just doing me a favor. Like, she's just taking one for the
team. She's like, okay, come on, put it in. Brittany, I've got croissants to make.
So we smoke a little weed first. And it was like, then the cool thing was like, there was no glass weed pipes. It was like a prototype.
Oh, shit. Like a metal one?
Yeah, but they're the shit. It's so funny that was the coolest pipe because they're fucking terrible.
Worse.
Yeah.
Nobody uses those anymore.
Nobody uses them. They're like brass, but it was like this. Yeah. So we're smoking. I'm super nervous. Like, okay. And then she's like, okay, fucking do this. And I'm like trying. And
were you able to get hard?
Oh, no, I was hard.
Oh,
I was
wow.
hard the whole fucking time.
Wow.
But I'm like trying, and I'm like, help. And they're like, wasn't going in, and she's like banging into the thing.
Oh God! Like you couldn't find the hole?
No, I found it, and I'm not saying like, oh, I have some. It's just she's young. It wasn't, and she wasn't like trying to help.
Oh, you know? Okay, yeah,
she's
yeah.
She's like,
yeah.
And then I'm trying, can't, and then finally, just about going a little, and then pull out, come in the toilet, and then her whole back's black and blue from hitting the thing.
Oh my God.
Not in a sexy way, you know? And then we just, and the whole time thinking, waiting for my grandma or grandpa to come in.
So stressful.
So it wasn't even really like sex, but in my mind.
Yeah, you're like, I fucking put a penis in a vagina.
Yeah,
that's
and
sex.
And I'm like, and I beat you to that. And then, we walk back like to school, and we never talked about it ever again. And then, like maybe a year later or something, my dad had this prostitute friend named Ramona. she really was named Ramona, and I would all, and she was like, I was high, and I'd say like, you owe me $2, and she'd be like, I do, and she'd give me the $2. Like, that was my big...
It's like how you take advantage of your grandma with dementia. Like, grandma,
same thing,
you forgot my birthday.
Heroin dementia.
Stop.
So then she'd always... So
give
then,
me $2.
So then my dad's like, do you want to have sex with Ramona to lose your virginity? I'm like, I already did it. So I didn't... No, not with Ramona.
How old were you when he offered that?
Like, just like... Because I didn't tell him I'd be... Yeah. I just didn't... And like 6 months later, I should take him on it.
And you were 13?
Well, then I was 14.
14.
But at the time, I was 13.
He's like, you want to have sex with Ramona?
Well, she was a prostitute.
Did you have sex with her?
No, I should have, because that would have been real sex. Like, she could have... Because from that time till I didn't really have sex again until I was probably 15 or something. Like, there was a dry spell from the last week of...
And then when you had sex again... After the first time, it was horrible.
I don't even remember the next one. I just remember that one because...
You don't even remember the next one?
I mean, not that I've like had sex with a million people. I just don't remember because it wasn't anything. It was probably... I do remember. I was 14, so it wasn't a few years. And it was... I won't say her name, but she was 18. And she had a red... one of those?
Corvette?
Not a Corvette. Porsche? Like a Fiat.
Okay.
Or something. And she's like... Bleach blonde. Ramona had bleach blonde too.
Wow.
And she let me drive the car. So that was really cool. But she was fucking everyone in the neighborhood.
The 18-year-old was fucking 14-year-olds?
Yeah, I don't know why.
That would not fly these days.
She was fucking 18-year-olds, 21-year-olds. I was the youngest of the bunch. But I started school early.
Wow.
Because my birthday.
Oh, was the cutoff?
Was December 3rd.
Okay.
The cutoff was December 2nd.
Right.
So my mom changed my birth certificate to December 1st. So I always had to do a fake birthday at school on December 1st. Well, she needed me out of the house so she could work. But then she thinks she shouldn't have done that because I was smart, but then
you were kind of
not mature.
Right, right, right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, and you were young.
Yeah.
And you were probably small, right?
I was small, yeah. And then like everyone got pubic hair before me and stuff. So.
You were like, you got it like 4 years later.
Yeah.
Like, you're like, what the like fuck?
Last week.
Yeah, you just got it just last week. Him, yeah. You just got it in the bathroom right now.
Totally.
That's so fucking crazy. Damn. Isn't it so crazy how like, I don't know, it's just so weird back in the day. Like, I mean, I feel like now people are finally getting called out on their shit, but I remember being like 16 dating a 22-year-old guy. I remember like so much of that. Like so just, much of that happened.
Everything.
People didn't care.
Yeah, just in everything, it was more Wild West.
And, yeah, people
and I didn't realize
fuck.
It was Wild West because I was thinking I already missed all the cool shit from like the 50s and the 60s. You know what I mean? I'm like, this is all.
And it felt
fucking
normal.
Everything felt normal.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I want fucking, you know, like I want to go to a fucking rockabilly concert, not like new one, like a real one from the, you know, like I want to see Chuck Berry. Miss that. Miss the Beatles. Think it's all over.
Right.
And then cut to like social media. And I'm like, oh no, we actually, it was fucking awesome. Like we played outside. We rode bicycles, skateboards, didn't have telephones. Didn't like, you just walked to the Beverly Center, walked to Taco Bell, walked to Arco, walked back.
It was fun.
We knew the numbers on the pay phones. Like, yo, is can you tell me if my buddy Johnny's there? They're like, is Johnny here? Yo, Johnny's not here. You know? Like, it's just...
Isn't that crazy that kids are never going to experience that? Like, I know exactly what you mean. I grew up without internet. It didn't come around until I was about graduating high school.
Yeah.
Was when we just got our first computer and, like, dial-up and all that shit. And, like, I just remember, like, it was just not a part of our childhood. You
I
know
think
what I mean?
There's a lot of awesome stuff, obviously, within it. It's like you have an Encyclopedia Britannica. Like,
right.
Like, if we're talking about something and you're like, what was the name of that tennis player?
Yeah.
You're like, da 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 da. But I feel bad that, like, I see younger kids and I'm sure, like, making a generalization, and I'm sure it's different in different parts of the world, but, like, I feel like, and all kids want to be in a rush to grow up. But you're still having fun as a kid. And I feel like they're just not having that as much.
I feel like they're not having that, like, genuine, like, go outside, scrape your knees, get grass stains kind
right?
of fun. You know what I mean? Like,
100%.
I feel like they're just, like, they grow up, their parents, you know, some parents are, like, a no TV parents or no internet parents. But I think a lot
That's
of parents.
Weird, too.
Yeah.
That's funny you said that.
And then they're outside the loop of, like, all their friends are on TikTok at, like, 6 years old. They're like, why am I not on TikTok, you know?
It's
like
funny, you said, my chick's like, why do you have no hair on your knees? Like, why are they all fucked up? I'm like, because they were scraped at all times.
So
always.
Many, so much.
You know what I mean?
Playing
and all
tag,
my jeans had fucking grass
rips.
Stains and then the fucked up patches that your mom fucking makes.
Genuine rips and holes,
you know?
And shit. And like, I had all boys in my neighborhood and my older brother. So I played with the boys all the time. And all we did was play Manhunt. Fucking tag,
Cowboys,
like,
and Indians,
like
Nazis
crazy
and Jews.
Shit. Well, I don't play that, but we didn't have any Jewish people in our neighborhood. We just had, like, you know, like we would just literally play games all night, and there were lightning bugs, and we'd take the lightning bug butts off and like stick them to each other and shit. It was fucking just being kids, you know, and it's just weird. Like, I just feel like so many people aren't going to get to experience that kind of real kid life.
Yeah,
you know?
I always like to hope that when something goes like one way, and then it goes the other way, and then hopefully it kind of meets
somewhere halfway. We kind of got,
and then
the
you
best,
look back,
and
you're like, you remember when it was way crazy, and then you remember that like it wasn't at all, and then you're like, now hopefully we're kind of normal, But I mean, who knows what's gonna happen? Like,
I think it's just gonna keep getting more and more evolved, which is scary. Like, I'm actually kind of freaked out by it. Like, it's great in terms of like medical advancements and things like that, people getting to live longer and whatnot.
Yeah. But is that greater? You know, I mean, who knows? But
no.
Medical advancements for sure.
Yeah.
And then now with the, not to talk about everyone else is talking about, but now with the pandemic.
Oh my God.
And then, like, you know, watching our like everything just go to shit.
Yeah.
you know?
I mean, this happened back in 1912, too. There was like a crazy pandemic.
Was that the Spanish flu or was that
I think it was the Spanish flu, yeah. And it was the same kind of thing.
People lived through it, yeah.
A lot of people died, sadly, just like they are now.
And then it's like Los Angeles just going to be like a thing of the where you're like, Los Angeles used to be cool. And now it looks like post-apocalyptic, like Terminator movie.
Tommy and I don't even want to live here anymore.
No, either do we.
Like, and we're like, literally thinking about moving, like, way up north because...
That's what we're thinking about moving.
Yes, like Santa Barbara.
Like, past probably that, past Montecito. That. I mean, I'd like to get just the fuck out of the country altogether.
Yeah.
Like where? And then just... Like, not that everyone's going to follow me or anything... But
everyone is. No, I'm just kidding.
Like, you know, like Cambodia or something like that.
You could live like a king out in Cambodia.
Oh, fuck yeah. I could have like 10 Cambodian chicks. No, I'm just kidding.
Dead.
Like 10 dead ones. No, it just, and then come here, like
yeah, for
tour,
right,
you know,
right.
And then I don't need, the only reason like I live in Los Angeles because I was born and raised there.
Yeah, yeah.
Like I didn't go there to work. And so I always stayed there except for when I went to Oregon for a while because my family was there and now there's just my mom and her husband.
Where's your sister?
My sister passed away a long time ago. Yeah,
I'm so but sorry.
That's all right. I mean, it was a long, not that it any easier, but it was
she your older or younger sister?
Younger sister.
Wow, I'm sorry.
So I mean, we have crazy stories together too. I just don't like I talk about a lot of stuff, but I don't really talk. I mean, and yeah. I'm not scared to talk about
right,
it.
Right,
I just usually keep that kind of stuff. Like, because it's more about it makes other people uncomfortable.
Well, I'm not uncomfortable.
No, not you. But yeah, you know,
yeah,
like,
I feel like, yeah.
Like you lose somebody and then like you're the guy, like you walk
everyone
into the
feels
room
bad
and
for
nobody
you.
Knows what to do. And then you have to act like overly like.
I'm okay. Everything's
yeah,
great.
And, like,
even though it's not.
Or,
yeah. But you don't
you
have
know.
To do that. Like,
no, I don't. I just like.
I feel
I don't. I never thought of myself as like a people pleaser and I'm probably not. And. My chick would be like, he's definitely not a people pleaser.
Yeah.
But I don't like people to be uncomfortable. I don't even like silence. You know,
yeah, no,
I mean,
neither do I. Like, I don't shut the fuck up.
Me up soon,
I get anxiety.
You know?
I feel you on that. That's crazy. I mean, you've really been through it. It's like kind of nuts. Like you've had this crazy life. But yeah, I mean, like I moved to LA when I was 17. And I mean, I've seen just LA has just gotten so gnarly. I mean, I went back to West Hollywood not too long ago and there's just... It's just sad. The homeless epidemic here is...
And it's sad for them, too. I'm not like...
Yeah, it's horrible.
I don't... And I know there's not like an easy fix.
No, there's not. So, I mean, there's tents everywhere.
But there's tents fucking everywhere.
And it like, wasn't like that 5 years ago.
And that shouldn't be a sight that you get used to
no,
seeing.
No, never.
You know what I mean?
The fact that you can walk
And I don't mean
by,
just like hide them somewhere like... If there's not an easy fix, but there's got to be some kind of
something.
Fix. Like, didn't they start Australia because it was like prison for like England... Like
it was all people that had all jail.
Some
that were
like
in jail,
can't there,
yeah.
There's lots of empty land in the universe. There has to be, and it's mm-hmm. like if you're like go here, learn
congregate.
How to farm,
yeah, yeah.
And if you don't, you're gonna die. Like you can yeah. make your drug, you could farm your drugs or make your grapes for alcohol, but if you don't learn how to feed yourself, you're gonna die. But you can't be
here,
like here, yeah. And then you can fly back when you. Get it together, you
the,
know.
The saddest thing I saw the other day was I was coming out of the grocery store and there's a little old man, he's about 80 years old.
I mean, that's
standing
sad already.
In the sun
yeah.
with a little handmade sign. He looked clean and put together and he had his pants on and a nice belt and he looked clean. He didn't look like disheveled.
And his
disheveled,
dick was hanging. Yeah.
Dead.
No,
but like he had a sign and he said, I'm a veteran. You know, the government doesn't pay me enough to pay for my apartment. Yeah, I'm taking anything that anyone can help me with.
It's fucked up.
And then I went and like looked it up and he was like, you know, just like an army, old school army veteran. Some of those guys retired in this age.
Oh, they don't get shit.
They're only getting like $200 a week. And to live in Calabasas or to live anywhere, $200 a week. Like,
and
you can't,
they don't admit that anything like happened to
no,
them. They're like no,
crazy.
There's no such thing as PTSD. And
yeah,
not to get like
guy.
Political or anything, but when you're young and, you know, you're poor or you're just young and you're
yeah.
like, oh, I'm going to go fight bad guys and, like, save the world. And it's like, you're just fighting for these fucking rich people. It's like, there's two pit bulls. They put the two pit bulls in the pit and, like, fight to the death. The pit bulls should really be like, let's go get a beer.
Yeah.
Fuck these. Like, let's eat these motherfuckers.
Yeah.
But they got you so confused. Like, it's like now, like, all the fucking
well, the army,
America, like,
yeah.
like dude.
the army gets you because they say, oh, we'll pay for your college.
Yeah, and they come into school and you're like, anything's better than fucking this.
Right.
You're like in some fucking.
Oh, and I get to shoot a gun and I get to blah, blah, blah.
And now they've already been doing this shit on the video games. Yeah. So by the time they get there, they've already been doing it for 10 years.
Yeah, I mean, like, I'm grateful for everyone that does fight for our country. I'm not saying I'm not grateful, and I know you're not either. It's just like...
No, I'm grateful for them. Yeah, it's
sad the way they're not.
But a lot of them, they come back and they're not even taken care of, you know?
No. So I actually saw this other guy who was like, you know, he came back from the army and he needed to get counseling. And they were like, oh, you're on like a 6-month wait list to get counseling.
He's like, I'm going to have a gun in my fucking mouth tomorrow.
Tomorrow,
like,
is thanks. What he said. Yeah. And I was like, oh my God. Like, it's like so sad. Like, I just... And I don't know what the answer is. Like, I don't know what it is.
You know, I don't know
how we went from,
and I know the weather is good here, so that's like,
yeah, of course, no one wants there, to be it's freezing.
Not, it's not every, there's certain places where it's not like that.
No,
you know, so what the fuck? And a lot of them, there's a lot of mental illness, a lot of drugs, a lot of the veteran thing. But now I just see kids on like BMXs. They probably just are like, they're on meth. They're like, well, why the fuck should I get an apartment? I don't sleep.
Yeah,
I don't eat.
Yeah.
Fucking, I'm on my BMX.
Yeah.
Like, just get a fucking little tent, throw it up under the fucking overpass.
And that's it.
And that's it.
Don't have to pay taxes. Don't have to pay bills. Don't have to do anything.
Why would you want to?
It's gnarly. It's just so weird. Like, I'm like wondering, like, I mean, so much has happened since then, but like, why back in like 1905 did we not have this problem? Like, what was different? You know,
it started, I guess, and then like bring it up after this and talk about something funny. But it started when Ronald Reagan, because I remember when
the
I was
Reagan
a kid,
administration, he got rid
kid,
of all the mental
you
institutions,
would see,
right?
Like, one, it was after this, you'd see literally like one dude, like, with the sign,
yeah,
and he was like, almost homeless.
Same.
You know
would
what I mean?
Never see any homeless people.
But it was, and then it was not this, but he closed all the mental hospitals.
That's what it was, right?
And then that was the beginning of it. And then it's like all, you know, the rich folk are like, pull yourself up from your bootstraps. It's like, it doesn't fucking work that way.
As someone who has like severe mental illness in their family, and I suffer from it myself, but not obviously to the point that I'm completely incapacitated, but pulling yourself up from your bootstraps is not.
Yeah, it's like that's like great not, when you're a billionaire's child and
yeah.
you like can do like make a million mistakes and then just keep, you know, it's like, have you ever tried to pull yourself up from your bootstraps?
Like, when you have like a brain
that
doesn't function.
Your brain
at, like,
doesn't
right
function
capacity.
Right.
Yeah.
Or you're in a neighborhood that isn't conducive to that.
Yeah.
Or it's like, well, you have the same opportunities that I have. Like, really? Does anyone have the same opportunities as anybody else?
I just wish
like,
they
plenty
would.
Plenty of people get a shitty fucking hand.
Hand, yeah. You get dealt a bad
you
hand
know?
Sometimes.
Don't have to feel sorry for yourself, but you can acknowledge that, like, you can't pull yourself up from your bootstraps without
so
help.
Easily,
you know
yeah.
what I mean?
Yeah. I recently just did a thing on my Instagram because I just was like, you know, I feel so privileged that I get to have therapy and get treatment and all that stuff. And I sold a bunch of my paintings and then paid for like a week of therapy
awesome.
For someone who couldn't afford it. And then like
so cool.
three sessions for someone who couldn't. And like, if everyone got together and just like, you know, gave like $4 or $5 a month or $1 if you can't, if you're on the lower end, $1
like,
a month
a lot?
To fund a facility that could take all of these
yeah.
people who are on drugs, all of these people with mental illness, maybe split it in half. Like the drug addicted people go this
yeah.
way, the mental illness people go this way.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of it is mental
Both.
Illness
yeah,
and
yeah.
then you do drugs because
yeah, yeah.
you can't cope with your mind. But to fund facilities in each state.
And a lot of them might not want to go. But
no, I know a lot
could,
of them.
Maybe
then,
that would just be a small, I mean, it's like so many, so not so many, so like so much money is with so little amount of people. Like, shouldn't they be, I don't know.
Even if they don't want to go, I think they should be forced
should,
to
yeah,
go because
yeah.
they're
and
killing
the, and
themselves.
And then the rich folks should be forced to put some
hey,
of that money to go
fucking
to those
take,
things.
I would happily pay.
No, me too.
$5 a month or whatever. And like, it could be a sliding scale. If you don't
yeah.
make a lot of money, you pay $1 a
totally.
Month. If everyone in every state
something
had to do that.
Something would change.
And it would go to these facilities, they could be funded.
I agree.
Do you know how many people are in California?
Yeah. But the people that have the power to do that, that's the last thing they want to, like, people
don't
get into
it.
Politics because they want to
help people.
They want fucking the money, they want the power, they want the, you know,
it's like they focus on so many things that are not the issue.
And you see, when a real issue like this happens, none of them know what the fuck to do.
Nothing.
Like
what has Donald Trump, not to shit on our president, but like, what has he done for this homeless
what is
situation?
What have any of the guys, like,
yeah.
like, you would think that's a pretty simple one. Okay, now here's the thing, like, let's help people. Like, that's not what they're, and you would think that those jobs should be for leaders.
Yeah.
Like, you should not even want it. Like, they force you. Mm-hmm. You're like, no, I don't want that. I don't want that job. And they're like, nope, you're the guy.
Yeah.
You're the fucking leader of the pack. You're the best one. Like, anyone who wants to do it ain't the guy.
No, because they're not one. It just feels like everyone's so fake. Like, I mean, I watched Joe Biden's speech last night, and I just was sitting there thinking, like,
like, we're fucked.
I was
way.
Just sitting there thinking,
I get it,
like,
anything but Trump, but it's like, okay.
Like, I'm just, I wish, like.
And then, you know, everyone's gone, sorry to cut you
no,
off.
No, of course.
But, like, everyone's gone political now.
Yeah, everyone.
And, like, they send you this dumb shit. Like, oh, they're all, like, this side's pedo. It's like, dude, it's, you really think, oh, only this side is like that. So now all the Democrats are pedophiles. Okay.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, bro. It's, this isn't a one-sided thing. They're all crooks.
Yes.
They're all fucking corrupt. But, like, you drank some Kool-Aid where you think it's like Donald Trump's going to save us from, like, pedophiles.
Like, dude, like, literally,
it's hilarious.
Both sides have fucked up shit going on. Like, both sides
have fucked up shit. And they're both, they're all on the take.
Yeah.
They're all fucking, you know, like, this new dude, my friend of mine that I didn't know was in it, he's, like, sending me, like, the four families of California, and it's crazy to watch because it's true.
Yeah.
And I'm like, you're right. That's fucking crazy. And they're crazy corrupt.
Yeah.
But I'm like, but then there's the ones who run this state and some of them are red and some of them are blue, but like, they just drink the fucking shit.
At the end of the day, it comes to greed. I think a lot of the people at the top, they don't want to help.
They don't
want to
lose it.
They don't want to lose it. They don't want to help people.
Some know. Like, some have a conscience, and they're like, yeah, that's fucked up that women can't do this, that black people can't do this. But, like, but we, like, I won, and I want to keep, I want to keep.
They're like, but I'll tweet about it, but I'm not going to, like.
About it. You know? I think you just got to, I guess, at the end of the day, you got to just be, like, as good a person as you can be. If this isn't conducive to, like, healthy life, go where it is. Go
I
to
just,
fucking
and Cambo- that's why
go
we,
to Cambodia.
Tommy and I said, we're like, I don't want to be around it anymore. And it's heartbreaking. And it's like, I feel powerless because it's like, as much as I could say, I would love to start like a whole movement where people donate and create a facility where these people can go. And, you know, I think they should be forcefully taken care of.
Well, maybe you're talking about it. Could be maybe some rich
person. Maybe someone will hear this and we can get together and, like, you know, do like a nonprofit, you know, where you just, we get people and they are able to create a place for these people. Because I feel like that's the biggest issue right now. Like, there's so much going on.
That's the biggest issue in Los Angeles.
Yeah, is Los Angeles. 100%.
And I don't think people can really get it because we'll even try to film it sometimes.
No, it's horrible.
But it doesn't even translate on the, it doesn't even translate there.
It's everywhere, you guys. Like, every overpass
is tense.
Tense.
And, some are clean, but a lot are not.
And now it's all along Hollywood Boulevard. It's just...
It's everywhere. And I guess the law, and I only know this because someone came on, and it usually stays out of the residential areas, but there was this fence on our block, residential. Mm-hmm. Totally hidden. The only reason we saw them, and it was like a mansion, it was like a homeless mansion, and we only saw because we were dog sitting Meadow's dogs because we don't have it, and then they walked up. So I find the dude, and then I'm trying to be cool, like, dude, I'm sorry that this is where you're at right now, but like, this is a residential block, like, you can't be here. And then he's like, it's eminent domain. Oh, and the dog's barking, but I'm like keeping him. And he's like, I'm going to have your dog put to sleep. I'm like, bro, I was trying to ask you nicely. Yeah. Like, now you're like making this a thing. So the cops had to come and get him because it was the neighbor's property.
Yeah.
I'm like, this isn't eminent domain. That's his fucking property.
Yeah.
And then, and all the cops tell him is like, you have to go to the sidewalk and there has to be 4 feet in front of you.
That's it. That's all they care
about. But like, that's crazy. You think they're doing that in Idaho or Wyoming or something? Just go to the sidewalk and keep. And I get that this is like supposed to be. That's not progressive. Like,
it's not like here.
It's like they just wanted.
We're going to take you to a place.
That's progressive.
And help you.
That's progressive.
What are you struggling
with?
Being
like, we love homeless people.
Yeah.
We let them be shit on themselves and be.
And do drugs and be addicted to drugs and be suffering from schizophrenia or whatever, you know? It's not fair. And a lot of them don't realize, you know, either, too, because I've met so many homeless people throughout my life, just giving to them, buying them sandwiches, giving them food, whatever. And so much of it is mental illness, and some of it's mental illness induced by drugs. And a lot of it is like, I mean, you can just see it. And it's like, you know, these.
I mean, I've been in those tents. Yeah. I smoked crack in those tents a long time ago.
It's sad. Anyway, I wish if that's something that, you know, the biggest thing that I think we should work on is like helping people that are just getting them off the street. That's not normal.
Yeah.
It's nothing. There's nothing normal about that.
About not having a toilet.
No.
Hopefully us talking about it, we'll do something. Because we're artists. Yeah. So when you try to not do what you do, like say you're like, I'm going to quit.
Yeah.
Doing what I do and I'm gonna go, you're not even gonna do a good job of it.
No.
Because it's
no one would ever take me or you seriously, which is sad.
Even if they did, it just like we can do more by talking than trying to do something that's out of our wheelhouse.
I try all the time like to help people individually, but like it's not like I like, you know, it takes so much more than that. You know what I mean?
And even if like you sponsored one person, is that really gonna do anything in the like
it's not enough.
Thing,
it's not enough. It's not enough. Anyway, so I don't know, guys, maybe like the next, you know, whoever's coming up or whatever, presidential nominee or something, God, maybe I'll write a fucking letter.
If you're a kid in school and like, this is something you
could
care about.
Establish or, you know, I would, if anyone's seeing this that would like to help, you know, God, it'd be great to start something, you know, where we could get a place for these people to go because it's just really sad. I mean, I know there are some shelters here and there, but I know like,
there's there's no way they can't all be packed if they're, like, there would have to be a thousand times whatever there is.
Yeah, and I know there's, like, a lot of rules. Like, if you have drugs on you, you can't come in. If you...
Yeah, and then how do you even get to A? Like, when I was saying the thing with my dad, like, how do you... Like, how many people did that probably stop from ever getting in? Because it's like, oh, well, if I could get 3 days to detox, why would I even be here to begin with? You know?
So, it's just become, like, a fucking... You have to just... It's like, every man for himself.
They can pack the prisons.
Yeah.
So why can't they do a new kind of thing where it's not a, like, and let's still let the greedy people make their money the same way they make it with the prisons, but just make a new kind of thing.
Facility.
Because they obviously know how to fill up these buildings.
And by the way, I see a lot of guys in prison on TikTok. So it's obviously
really?
Not that bad. There's so many.
Oh, that's so awesome.
It's like, called prison talk.
How they're allowed to get on the computer.
Dude, they have, hidden phones.
That's what I would do.
They are living the life,
If I was risking getting busted for my cell phone, I would definitely want to do a dance on TikTok.
They're doing it, and they're like, if they hashtag prison talk.
I'd be like, could you bring me a fucking hacksaw, please?
Bro, they're not even scared.
I don't need a TikTok. Bring me a hacksaw.
Dude, they're not even bummed. Like, they're all fucking just dancing.
I mean, I guess that's probably
they're rolling blunts. Like,
you're like, that looks fun.
I know. I'm like,
where do I sign up?
That doesn't look like prison to me, but the
looks like college.
Yeah, it's weird. But then you see the metal door with the little thing. You're like, oh, okay.
Yeah, and you hear some guy getting raped in the back.
It's horrible. Anyway, you're right. It would be good if they could do some kind of facility the way they facilitate something the way they facilitate prisons. But anyway, who knows? God, it's not in our hands. I'm clearly not a political member. Yeah. Dear God, help us. Anyway, I've loved having you on here.
Yeah, thank you.
It went
so
fast.
Yeah,
guys, follow Mickey. It's just at Mickey Avalon on Instagram.
On Instagram, it's Mickey_Avalon.
Okay.
On Twitter and Facebook, I believe it's just Mickey Avalon.
Yes.
And then I also paint. Yes. I was a painter before.
Support artists.
I was a painter before I got into music. I've been supporting myself through the pandemic by doing commissions for people. And I got a raffle going on for 2 paintings. And by the time you see this, the raffle will be Monday, September 14th and 15th.
Okay.
I think it's 14th and 15th or 15th and 16th, but you'll have like 4 days to get the tickets and hopefully win the paintings.
Guys, support artists.
Support artists.
Hard times right now. Like people that are, I'm so lucky my husband's, you know, so successful because fuck, it is a hard time for a lot of people.
And
right
he's got
now.
A big ass dick.
And he's got a huge wiener, which I love. Love that thing. God bless him. But you know, I'm telling you, like I'm, you know, just try to give back as much as you can. It comes full circle. I will tell you that right now.
Yep.
I mean, it's
like we've been buying
crazy.
Bands, t-shirts. I don't need to support Elvis, but newer bands. Like we've been buying, like, and normally I wouldn't be that guy.
Right.
Like, it was really my chick who got into it. She's like, we need to take money that we're making and buy t-shirts and buy merch.
It's important.
And,
everyone does.
Yeah. So
and I know you're not like, you know, fucking, you know, it's like you don't have to do that, but you do, which is nice.
Yeah. And I'm not rich or anything,
you're not,
but
like,
it's just a good, and we don't like tithe our money, but it's just a good thing to like,
always
buy a t-shirt and, you know, for like
help
the
out.
Up and coming bands.
For sure. So make sure to follow him, join in on that raffle, and we will see y'all next week on Worst Facts.
All right.
Bye.